Can you still calcify or shrink plaque with pre-diabetes numbers? My numbers seem stuck in the low 100s taking metformin. Is additional medication required? Went to a ketogenic diet. Well, the number one priority is diet. Number two priority is diet. Number three priority is diet. Then you get exercise. One of the components of diet, it has to do with body fat. You need to really, again, that's what some of this testing does. It helps you understand how much of an impact things like body fat are having on you. Now, metformin decreases. We don't really understand all the different things that metformin does. We know that metformin decreases gluconeogenesis, meaning glucose newly made in the bloodstream. That's what your liver does. And metformin decreases that, but it does other things too. It impacts the gut biome. Well, how do we know that? Because you get gas and diarrhea. At least one out of five people do when they start metformin. But did you know that the gut biome is very much associated with whether or not you have prediabetes? I'm not going to spend more time going down that bunny trail, but look it up. I've got some videos on it. So metformin does a few things. The root cause issue does not appear to be that much impacted by metformin, and that is the sensitivity of the insulin receptor to insulin. Now, there is a drug, while we're talking about drugs, there is a class of drugs that does that. They're called thiazolidinones. The most common, the most well-known is pioglitazone. The early trade name for pioglitazone, since we've blown advertising, we're just going to go ahead and mention commercial names anyway. You'll recognize it better. It's called Actos. That was an extremely popular drug 20 years ago. There are two very clear ways to increase your insulin receptivity to insulin. One is losing body fat. Another is decreasing cortisol with sleep and stuff like that. But on a reliable, dependable, you can watch it happen basis, decreasing body fat is the most common thing that I see. The second big item I see is the people that start pio. Now, pio is a prescription drug. It's got some significant side effects. One of them is it's been associated with bladder cancer. It's been associated with some water weight gain. So you should take two or three looks and investigate deeply before you go on to something like pio. I will tell you, I take it. I don't take it every day. But here's why. The probability of side effects on something like that, even one of the more dangerous prescription level drugs, is minuscule compared to a 10 or 20% probability of having a heart attack or stroke over the next decade or two. And those are the kind of numbers that we're talking about. So, yep, I come on and I talk about a drug, I'm going to get a lot of haters. So be it. You got to know the facts. So I'd like to talk with you a minute about the webinar. People don't understand what the webinar is. It's actually a great way to get some access to healthcare that you're just not going to get any other way. You actually get the lab tests yourself at a local lab, a Quest lab near you, for the inflammation panel and the OGTT and the insulin survey. These are things, inflammation and prediabetes, that your doctor just does not know about. And here's the thing. Harvard Health and many others have said, look, sudden death is not always so sudden. The Hollywood picture that it's a bolt out of the blue is not realistic. It's more like real lightning, preceded by clouds, wind, and rain. Stop that metabolic storm before the lightning strikes. And here's where that metabolic storm comes from. It's inflammation, and it has to do usually with prediabetes. So again, we actually get labs, we go over them in the webinar, and then you can start finding out how you can prevent that heart attack others said that you couldn't even predict. We can show you how. Thanks.